coffee, my old friend. I've come to order you again. I hear the grinding of espresso beans. I need a double shot of pure caffeine. And the indie band on the speaker soothes my brain, so I'll remain within the sounds of Starbucks, trying to brew my own at home, but felt so quiet and alone. I need to be amid the morning rush, where the leather chairs are soft and plush, and I'll drink a grande cappuccino with a pumpkin scone and charge my phone. Listen to the sounds of Starbucks. Then I heard an awful scream. They had totes run out of cream. A new employee spilled the coffee grounds, and the Wi-Fi went completely down. And a lady in yoga pants threw her latte at the wall. The cops were called. Then came the sound of sirens. And in the drive-thru lane I saw 1,000 hipsters, maybe more. People paying without drinking. People waiting, they were all freaking. People going off, 'cause they couldn't get a caramel frap. Holy crap. A riot started at Starbucks, while a Bible study prayed. Baristas formed a barricade. The manager cried out a warning to the angry mob that was forming. And he said, I checked Google Maps, there's another one across the street. So we stampede, return to the sounds of Starbucks.
How'd you like that intro? Got back last night and decided I should do something extra special for you guys since I didn't put out any content yesterday. But I did get the stagecoach safely delivered. In fact, here's the reveal.
Well, folks, here's Wild Bill with his delivery of his stagecoach.
Yeah. That's my stagecoach, buddy. I've been waiting 2 weeks for it.
Well, I'm glad you're enjoying it.
But the master model builder did the job.
Oh, you're too kind.
We crossed the burning desert in the Arizona sun. A thundering desert dragon, watch us run, watch us run. We carry precious cargo, we've got precious little time. And there's trouble up ahead and close behind. Stagecoach, rolling on the glorious stagecoach. Geronimo is waiting, there's Apaches on the hill. Staring at the cavalry, out to kill.
Everybody's happy. And while I was there, a little something else happened I totally forgotten about. It tells you how my memory's going. In fact, this gave me an idea for the question of the day. Did you ever build a model that you forgot you had built? In other words, you saw the model and I'm like, oh, who built that? And like, you did. I'm like, I did? I don't remember building that. Well, the gentleman who I made the stagecoach for, retired Army man, and he had, when he was in the Army, he trained on the 01 bird dog. Well, I guess in the Army it was the L-19. Anyway, so he has a couple of models of it, and I saw a little bird dog on the shelf, and I was like, who built that? It was an Airfix bird dog. He goes, you did, and I had totally forgotten. And it's like, how could I forget? It's one of my favorite models. How could I forget building that? But another thing that had happened was I had, when I was a shiny new captain at the Regional Airlines back around 2000, 2001. I guess it was 2000. Anyway, my first posting was Columbus, Ohio. And I was largely on reserve, but finally got a line. Anyway, point is that I didn't want to just move everything up to Columbus. Of course, back in those days, almost everything I owned fit in my car. So I got a little, efficiency apartment near the airport for $400 or $500 a month. And I bought a car on a credit card, which, by the way, was the second time I had done that. I used by these fairly cheap cars. Actually, not a bad car. Oldsmobile? Anyway. I was building models, and I remember I built the monogram Shangri-La P-51B Viscount airliner, which was the Glencoe kit. And I did it for, given that I didn't have a air gun, I did a not half bad Gloster Gladiator. And I'd stumbled across the pictures recently when I was looking, little bird dog, I looked at, there's the Gloster Gladiator that I had built. And I was like, what's that doing here? And I had forgotten that during one of my moves, I didn't want to throw my models away, so I had just given them to him because he has a room full of memorabilia. And I had totally forgotten what I'd ever done with it. I had been thinking a while back, what did I do with that Gladiator? I don't even remember. And then I saw that, oh, that's right. I gave this stuff to Wild Bill because he had a place to put it all. So, did you ever build a model that you forgot you had built, maybe saw it later or somebody brought it up and you're having like, I don't remember that, just, So, I wore a couple of accoutrements today. This is my replica Apollo 15 bull of a watch my wife got for me. It's a replica of the one that John Young wore on the Apollo 15 mission. And I wore my Star Trek pocket watch that Eduardo got me. And I was thinking about real space and sci-fi. And for any of you guys that model that stuff, of course, science fiction holds a reasonable chunk of the kit model world. And real space, maybe not quite as much, but it does too. And I really do enjoy doing both. Since I grew up in the 60s in Florida, you know, I followed the space program religiously. I thought it was the coolest thing ever. I remember being 9 or 10 years old and talking to my brother on the phone. I want to be he'd gone to Georgia Tech. I want to be an astronaut. Okay, you got to learn math. I don't want to be an astronaut that bad. You know, the things are really nothing alike, and they're everything alike. They're nothing alike because science fiction is just, let's face it, it's just basically fantasy for the most part, whereas science, real space, is about as hardcore science fact gets. But they both strike at that chord for adventure and exploration, and they're both nothing I'll ever get to do, but you know, we live on this magnificent little blue marble in space, and yet half of our fantasies are about leaving it. And I assume that just has to do with our natural curiosity about the universe we live in. Of course, I'm sure all you guys know we're not going beyond the solar system and chemical rockets. So until there is some Star Trek-esque type breakthrough in travel technology, this is home. But that's okay, because I like it. There's a lot to do here when the food's good. But it does make me wonder, as our technology advances, will we as a species, I hope we as a species advance, but as our technology advances, we have the opportunity now through model building to sort of project ourselves a direction. I mean, I don't think we'll ever see the days of Star Trek, who knows, but although the real Star Trek's a hopeful vision, but when you look at things like the 2001 moon bus and some of the science fiction vessels that are kind of a blend of projected real space, like the Odyssey from 2001, vehicles we could build, the Pan Am Clipper from 2001, these are things we could do. And I hold out hope that we will. And the beauty of model building of something that's kind of this, it's science fiction, but it borders on real space, is that it really does, whereas Star Trek's pretty far out there, but the stuff that we could, maybe not in our lifetimes, but our kids or grandkids could see, that's, to me, that's really stimulating. I don't know if it'll be people like Musk and Bezos, or it'll be a government that'll ever get this done, but we could do it. And when I built the copy of the Pan Am Clipper, which I have no idea what I did with that, back then it was just a cheap model. Now you see what people are asking for them on eBay, you're like, huh? But when I would build that, I always thought, this is such a simple kit. There's really not that much to it. I weathered mine a little bit. But, and the movie was a little hard for a kid to follow. And by a little hard, I mean completely impossible. But it's still, I'm like, why am I enjoying this so much? Because this could happen. This could be real. This could be our future. And let's face it, you go... I remember when I went shopping. The other thing about that Pan Am ship was when I went shopping as a kid, there were some space vehicles, of course, now I wish I'd bought them all, but there were some space vehicles you would look at and they just didn't really do anything for you. But that Pan Am Orion, the 2001 moon shuttle, it looked enough like an airplane to be intriguing, enough like a spaceship to be intriguing. It was whoever designed and thought that thing out, it was a very clever layout, design. It had box art appeal as well as being scientifically plausible. So kudos to them. And I do remember building that one. I think I only built the one time though. Somebody else I know had one though. Another one that I've never had, I should probably get, that was kind of cool and didn't get a lot of screen time. We all know from the UFO and Space 1999 series, the Eagle transporters and the UFO interceptors, and those are, and I've got the interceptor, and those are cool. I need to get an Eagle. I've never built an Eagle. Now, here they're a little tricky to build. They're fairly complicated. But the one that never got much love was the UFO moon hopper. It looked kind of like an ant. I always thought that was pretty cool. The guys who worked for Jerry Anderson in the props shop, they must have had a good time working there. I can only imagine what it was like. If I ever get a chance to meet Matt Irvin, I'm sure like every other geeky model builder, I'll just bug the crap out of him about what it was like working in the shop. And, man, that would make a cool interview, wouldn't it? Wow. What's it like to work in a Hollywood prop shop? Yeah, I'm sure, we could also do prattle on or listen to them, probably, talk all day about that. I'm the one that prattles on here. I'm making this stuff up as I go, but for someone to actually talk about what they were doing there, that would be just, And then what did you do? I don't know what kind of time deadline they worked on. I bet they didn't have a lot of time. But I've never seen a picture of one of these Hollywood model makers with a frown on his face. They're always, you know, I make models for a living. Yeah. Well, guys, thanks for tuning in. And hopefully, now I can work on that XP50. And hopefully tonight I'll have something to show you. And other than that, I do want to get this, try and narrate the Squadron Shop video today. And that's going to be more of a kind of a podcast kind of thing. I don't have a lot of images to go with it. But like I said, given the information they put on their own website, if I hadn't just been sidetracked with so many other things, I'd already have that out. But my plan is to at least get it recorded, maybe get it up today. Other than that, guys, you have a great day, and we will see you this evening. Bye-bye.